Hello, students, and welcome back to the spring semester already in progress. I hope you guys are doing well. I know it's been a weird couple of weeks, not just at Pima, but in life in general has been kind of weird with the whole coronavirus. But we're going to marshal on and carry on and go get through all this. Now we're doing the online teaching thing, and so I'm making videos for you guys, and I'm going to keep you posted on what's happening with the work for the class, etc. Now, I want you to feel free to contact me anytime you want. There is my email address, which you probably have, but you can also contact me through the website. So, for example, over here on the website, if you click on the contact form button up there, you can fill this out, and this will go directly to me, and I'll respond to you usually within 24 hours, if not much sooner than that. So I wanted to talk to you about a couple of things today. First of all, on Wednesday, your website assignment is due. I pushed the deadline back because of all the weirdness that we've been going through. And so you're probably wondering, you probably have some questions or maybe some problems that you need to solve. Feel free to email me with a list of your questions and problems, and I'll do what I can to help you answer those and solve those so that you can have a better looking website on Wednesday. But as I was sitting here working on the class website, it occurred to me that there was something I wanted to do that might be a, sort of a teachable moment. So let me show you what I'm talking about. On my website here, you know, I log into it every week. And what I do is I take the old posts from the previous week and copy them and make new posts out of them. But I do it all manually. So, for example, I'll go into my posts here, I'll go into the web design one for week 9. And what I've been doing is, you know, copying this whole post and then clicking add new up here and, you know, pasting the old post in and then putting, you know, like week 10 or whatever up here and, you know, making my changes, right? And that's cool, but it's kind of a drag when you do it for, you know, 6 different classes every week. So what I'm trying to show you here is if you have a need, there's probably a plugin that will help you solve it. And there's probably a free plugin that will help you solve it. So just sitting here getting ready to do this today. And I was like, wait a minute, how do you, maybe there's a way to, like, you know, create a duplicate post in WordPress. Now I've looked in WordPress before. I've looked in their list of posts, you know, to see if there was any way to duplicate. You know, I've clicked on this quick edit section here. There's no way to duplicate. So I went to our old friend, the internet, and just typed in a search query, duplicate posts in WordPress. And the first thing that came up was, hey, there's a plugin called, of course, duplicate post. So what I'm trying to show you here is that, you know, as I said, if you have a problem or, you know, that you want to resolve or even just something you want to do, somebody has probably crossed that bridge already. And so if you can think of some keywords that will help describe what it is you want to do, and you put those into either the Google search engine or maybe the post search engine in WordPress, you can often find the thing that you're trying to do, right? Something that will help you do the thing you're trying to do. So let's go ahead and solve my problem here. So I'm going to go to plugins. I'm going to go to add new. I'm going to click in the search box here and type duplicate post. And sure enough, it's one of the first things that comes up. And so, you know, as a reminder, I always look at these different things. I look at the star ratings. It says 5, you know, with a fair amount of people, over 400. It's got over 3 million active installs, which is always a good sign. And this one I love. When somebody's updated something recently, that means that they're staying in touch with their software and making updates. It's really the scary ones are the ones that say, you know, last updated 2 years ago or even 6 months ago. The sooner the better for updates, right? So let's click on install now. Okay, and then activate, of course, turn it on. All right, so now we've got duplicate posts right here. Now, you know, if I want to investigate this, I can always click on the settings and, you know, see what's in here, you know, make my changes and stuff. But right here in Google, it told me how to use it. It said, now go to post all posts and hover over the post. To copy a post, click on clone to duplicate the post, okay? So now that same thing that I did a little earlier where I was cutting and pasting into a new post, let's see if we can make it, that work a little better. So this time I'll hover over web design, and look, there's a new choice here, which is clone, right? So if I just hit clone, let's see, where did it do? Oh, here it is. It made a copy of it and it put it into what's called draft mode, which means it's not published, it just exists, right? So that right there is gonna save me a ton of time. I can click on this now and I can change this date. Now, I'm not gonna change it to week 10 because that was our spring break. And come to think of it, so was week 11. So this is actually week 12 here, right? So I can save this in a draft format and then make my changes. And then when I'm all done, go ahead and hit the publish button. And this will be the post for this week. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and pause the video right here so I can jump over to another thing that I want to talk to you guys about. Okay, so I jumped over here to the w3schools.com website, and you can do the same if you like, and come over here, and this is, of course, where we've been doing some tutorials, and of course, they have the great HTML and CSS tutorials here. So right here, it's showing a bunch of HTML tutorials, right? If we click on tutorials, we can click down here to learn CSS, and it will take us into the CSS home, which is the first tutorial. Now, we've gone through some of these already. The reason I'm here is because, as you know, I told you before the class let out for spring break that we had a couple more assignments we were going to do in the class. The first one is you're going to turn in the website you've been working on all semester on Wednesday. And we're all going to take a look at that and make comments in the forum about that. But the other two things are you're going to have a CSS take-home test, and you're going to, which is going to be very, very similar to the HTML test that you did, and you're going to do one more website by the end of the year. So what I'd like to do is spend a little time talking about CSS and the things that will be in the take-home test, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up a word processor here, and I'm going to start doing some of these CSS examples and then cut and paste them over to the word processor so that I can make a study guide for you for you know, the things you'll need to work on for this CSS take-home test. All right, let me get the word processor started up. Okay, so I started up my word processor. I use OpenOffice. And I've got that on half the screen, and then I've got the CSS tutorial over here on the other half of the screen. So I'm going to go ahead and click in here and, you know, type in CSS study guide. And this is what I'll provide you guys with to study. And of course, you know, I recommend you go to this CSS tutorial on W3 Schools and do some of the lessons there. As you're going through this guide to sort of reinforce how this stuff works. So the first thing we should talk about are the different kinds of CSS styles or selectors that there are, right? So we know that a CSS style is also referred to as a selector. That's sort of the official term for it, right? And there's a couple of different ones. The first one is one that we've used a few times. It's called a class. And a class is indicated by a dot. And what it means is that it is a general style. Okay, so let's do an example of that. So, for example, if you wanted all of your headlines to be, all your H1, you know, your biggest headlines to be blue, that's kind of a general style, right? So let's say one example of this would be H1, which is the headline one tag, and then the biggest headline. Then you put in your curly braces, and you go up here and you say what it is you want to happen, right? In this case, I want color, which is the text color, to be blue. And I close that off with a semicolon, which means end the line. Now, this is the selector right here, this whole piece of code here. And what we're doing is, okay, so we want to make a class, which is a general style, right? So in a class, I have to put a dot here, right? So let's just say that instead of an H1, let me switch this over to a proper class. So let's just say blue headline is what I want to call this class, right? Okay, so now I have a dot here which corresponds to the class, right? And I say I want my blue headline class to turn everything blue, right? So this is on my CSS style sheet, right? In the actual HTML for the page, I would have to, you know, put some text, like here's some text, right? And then let's say that I put that inside of like an H1 tag, so it's a big piece of headline there, right? But then inside of the H1 tag at the beginning, I say class equals blue underscore headline. Okay, so what's going to happen is this text here is going to turn blue. Now, when you say class equals, you put the name of the class in quotes, and then this word class gets replaced with a dot up here in the CSS. So up there, that's the CSS. This is the equivalent HTML, right? Now, something just occurred to me, which is it'd be a lot easier to do this little tutorial on the right in Dreamweaver, because it would go ahead and render all the code as I do it. So I think I'm going to switch over here from OpenOffice to Dreamweaver, and then recreate this and then continue with the tutorial. Okay, I've got Dreamweaver started up, and I'm just going to go ahead and, just for grins, paste all my text in from that other OpenOffice page, this CSS study guide stuff here, right? Now, what I'll do is I'll go ahead and try and make this a little more presentable. So I'm inside the body tags here, which is, you know, here's the beginning body, and down here is the end body tag, right? And so this is where all my code is going to go. So for example, if I type an H1 tag around this, put an H1 tag around the CSS study guide, then that's going to get big, like a big headline, right? Now I can also, if I want to center this, I can, you know, try a couple of different things. I can say align equals center and see if that works, right? Sometimes the things that you think will work won't work, so you have to experiment with a couple of different ones. But here we go. So we have an H1 tag CSS study guide that's right up there, right? Now, down here, you'll notice that all this text that I just kind of typed, it all comes in one line instead of multiple lines. And that's because each of these needs to have a paragraph tag around it in order to be a new line, right? So if I put a begin paragraph and an end paragraph around that, then that becomes its own line, right? Now, I highly encourage that you copy and paste, but be careful when you do it, because, you know, as I've said in the past, HTML is very unforgiving. Well, really all coding languages are very unforgiving. If you make a mistake, they'll just hose you and you'll have to try and find the mistake. Okay, so here by putting those three paragraphs tags in, I've taken my text and formatted it the way that I wanted to, right? Now, this stuff down here, this is actually a style or a selector that I made, and it doesn't belong down here in the HTML part of the code. It belongs up at the top in a style sheet that we're going to put, an internal style sheet we're going to put on here. Now, as you know, most websites are made with external style sheets. It's an external file, but it's just much easier to put that stuff in here and work on it. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. So if you want to add a style to a page, you have to put the style tag in between the head tags of the HTML. And then in between those style tags, you can paste your selectors, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this style or selector out of there, and I'm going to put it up here. Okay, so now when it's between the style tags, that means it's a style, right? And I say that dot blue headline is going to turn the color of the text blue. I'm going to try and clean this up a little bit here. And so let's see, let's go down here and let's see. Okay, here we go. Here's some text, class equals blue headline. Okay, so let's take this out of the H1 and let's just put it into a paragraph tag and see if it'll be a little friendlier to us. Okay, this may be one of those things that happen in class where you have to like save this file and then sometimes refresh Dreamweaver for it to show you what it's supposed to be doing. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go ahead and save my file. So I'll just go, I'll set up a new site here, which is something you can always do. It's a good idea to do when you start working in Dreamweaver. So I'll go under site name and I'll say CSS study guide. And I'll put a folder somewhere on my computer. So I'll go to my desktop here, make a new folder, call it CSS study guide, create it, and hit choose. So now that is what's called my local site. And I hit save, and now all of my files will be saved into that folder, which is what you want. You want everything to be in one folder in Dreamweaver. Okay, and so I'll take this little files tab here, see if I can stick it up here with all these other guys. Okay, good. All right, now I want to save this. So the first page of your website you always save as an index page. So we'll call this index. Notice I'm using lowercase letters. And index.html is always the first page, right? Okay, so we can look down here and we can see that it's showing some kind of error in my code here. So let me go up here and look at what's going on. So dot blue headline, that's correct. Color blue, that's all correct as well. So it's giving me an error. The value of attribute class must be in double quotes. Oh, this is the problem, actually. You see how you see these quotes here? These are called curly quotes. And I copied and pasted those from OpenOffice. But HTML uses what are called straight quotes, right? So it's not getting that this is the name of the class because of my curly quotes, right? So when I do that, the second I do that, see how the text becomes blue here? So that was the problem. Now, unfortunately, these red error messages, they don't always go away like they should. Maybe if I save this, so file save. Yeah, there it goes. The red error message went away. Now, sometimes you'll have a red error message and there won't actually be an error and everything will look fine and it's just a little gremlin in the system, right? Okay, so let's continue on with this. So I can take this HTML out because now we're in the HTML section of the document. Everything has a paragraph around it, so everything is as it should be, right? Okay, good. So that was a class, right, which is used for something general, like making text a certain color. Another example that we have in CSS, another type of selector, is an ID, right? So let me go down here. I'm going to copy some stuff and go down here and paste in, this same text again so I can use it again. But I'm going to change it. CSS style equals selector. Okay, we've already got that up there. So let's do the next one. So this one is called an ID, and it is indicated by a pound sign, and it is generally only used once. Okay, so let's do an example of this. And of course, if you click up here in the white area, it's going to refresh the front end of your website and show you what you just did, right? So, an ID is only used once. So, something that you would really only have one of on a web page is something like a div, a very specific div, like what we call a container div, which surrounds all the content of the website, right? So, if I go down here and I in my HTML section of the site, which is everything between the body text here. Well, actually, this is all an HTML page, so I'm typing HTML, but my content is between the body tags and my style is between the head tags up at the top there. So I'm going to go ahead and type a div, which is short for division. It means a section, right? And it's Dreamweaver is going to put the end div tag there for me. And I'll say, here is a div, right? Now, if I want to go ahead and give this div some style, I can go ahead and put in an ID here. So I'll just type ID equals, and then I'll say, something like my div. That's the name I'm going to call this div, right? Now, so far, if I click in here, you see the text content for here is a div, and then this line around everything shows you that there's actually a div wrapped around it, right? That won't show up on the final web page, but it'll show up here in Dreamweaver. Now I have to, let me go ahead and change the percentage of black and white showing here on my screen. It'll come up like this so we can see more of the coding here. So now I want to add a style. So I go up between my style tags here and I add a new style. This time I'm adding an ID, which of course is a pound sign. And I'm going to put in my div because that's the name of the div down below that I called a ID. Now, as soon as I started typing that, Dreamweaver looks for any IDs that are on the page and brings them up so you can select them if you just want to do it that way. Okay, so we're always going to put the name of the selector up there. Then we're going to put a curly brace and we're going to hit our enter button. And Dreamweaver is going to, you know, oftentimes it will tab it over for us and put in this kind of presentation, which is, you know, it's a good way to do things. You want to be consistent with your style, right? So what I want to do here is I want to give my div a width and a height and a background color. So I'm just going to go in here inside the parentheses and I'm going to type width, 500 pixels, semicolon, which ends a line, a height. I'm not sure why it's doing this crazy double indent here. Height, and then of course the colon means equals, and we'll say 100 pixels. And semicolon to end it. And of course, background, which also means background color, and we'll just put something like red so it's easy to see. Okay, now when you're typing your style in here, it doesn't show up right away in the front end of the website, but the second you click in here, it updates, and now we see our style, right? Okay, so we talked about, you know, we're talking about selectors right now, and a class is a dot, it's a general style, and here's an example. An ID is a pound sign, and it's generally only used once, like you might only have one header div on a page, so you could use something like an ID, right? Okay, so let's look at some of the other styles that we can use. So I'm going to go ahead and, you know, grab this code that I've been using here, copy it, paste it in underneath this. Okay, and then maybe tab it over a little bit so it looks a little more normal, right? Okay, so the next one is what we would call a tag. Now, as you know, a tag is something that is surrounded by these angle brackets. Like this P is a tag because it has angle brackets around it. It's called the beginning or left angle bracket and the ending or right angle bracket. Of course, the slash indicates what the ending tag is. This is the beginning tag and the ending tag, right? Now, a tag is an existing tag, we'll say such as P, paragraph, right? And I'll only put one in there because I don't want it to actually create a paragraph. Well, that's problematic because there's a paragraph here. So such as, I'll just write it, such as P in angle brackets, that you are adding custom style to. Okay, for example, whenever you create a paragraph, it puts a certain amount of room between that line in the paragraph and the content above it, right? But if for some reason you wanted that to be more or less space, you could come up here to your style area and you could just put the letter P, which means paragraph, right? And now you could go ahead and redefine the values of that paragraph, right? The space on top is often referred to as the margin, okay? And in this case, it would be the margin top. And you could put in a number here, like one of my favorite kinds of numbers to use are what are called EMs, which are proportional units of measurement. So they always look the same in every kind of device, from laptops to desktops to mobile to tablets, right? Now, if I go ahead and say, hey, for every paragraph, I want the margin on the top to be 2 EMs, and then I click in here, all of these should get further away from each other, and they do, right? What you can also use negative numbers. So if I say negative 2 EMs, everything gets kind of crazy smashed up together. You can also use, dotted numbers like 2.2 or something like that. It really doesn't matter. So when it comes to things like spacing, it's better to use M's than pixels. In fact, if I had to go back and redo this this div here, I would probably do it in M's because, as I said, M's work the same across all devices. Pixels don't. Pixels are device dependent. Okay, so now I've just redefined a tag, which is the paragraph tag. In the example, let's see, for my paragraph tag here, I'll say, the example is that I added margin top to all paragraphs P tags on the page. Okay, look in the style section to see the example. Okay, so that's my little example. I got to wrap this whole thing in a paragraph so that it will make a nice line of space like that. Okay, and then I click here and you can see all that extra space here. Now two EMs is pretty big. 2.2 is pretty big. So maybe let me try like 1.2 or something and see if that's a little more reasonable. Okay, I feel better about that. Okay. So we have classes. This first one up here is a class. Let me go ahead and tap this over because as I said, consistency is important. And you want to produce what's called well-formed code. A well-formed code is when all your code looks very clean and is well-formatted, and there's space between things like different styles so that they're easy to find. And what I like about Dreamweaver is it color codes everything so it's easy to find. Like you can see, all of the classes are here in this, or the IDs are in this blue. The classes are going to be in this green. You can see numbers are in green. Selectors here or values are in purple, and so on and so forth. So it makes it easy to locate things. Okay, the next thing we want to talk about is a compound tag. Now, a compound tag is when you take two tags and you put them together, right? So for example, let's say that we want so now we're going to do a compound tag, right? So let's go down here and copy this stuff here so we can do another example. Paste it in here and we'll say a compound tag is several tags used in conjunction, such as P in angle brackets along with pound sign my div or something like that, that you're adding custom style to. We'll leave that part, right? Example, and I'll say we made a compound tag that targets paragraphs inside the my div container, right? Or the my div, right? Okay, we'll say inside my div. We'll take off the V. Okay, so I went ahead and explained it before I actually did it. So now I'm gonna go ahead and do the style up here. So I scroll up here to the style area. And now what we're going to do is we're going to say, hey, we want to go ahead and make a style that targets my div, which of course is this red div right here. But we only want to target or make changes to paragraphs, which are inside my div. So we're going to go ahead and put the curly braces in. And we're going to go ahead and put in our attribute here, which is background, and then we're going to put in our value, which is yellow, and then a semicolon, right? So now what we're saying is, if you're inside the MyDiv div, this red area, and you're wrapped with a paragraph tag, you have a paragraph tag around you, we want you to be yellow. Okay, so what we do is we go down here to MyDiv. We can leave that here as a div alone, right? And then we can, I can go ahead and hit my enter key a couple times so I can put some more text. But this time I want to put a paragraph tag in and say, this text is on a yellow background. Okay. And then when I go up here, you'll see that when I said, you know, background equals yellow, it means the background for the entire paragraph, which is this whole line here, right? So once again, this is a compound tag, and you can tell that compound, of course, means more than one thing. We have two things together here. We have two selectors, basically. The custom ID we made called MyDiv ID, of course, means that there's a pound sign there, and then a paragraph tag, right? And that makes the custom tag. Now, these are the four main kinds of tags that you can, or I'm sorry, the four main kinds of styles or selectors you can use in a CSS. And of course, there's variations on these, but a class, which is indicated by a dot and is a general type of style, an ID, which is indicated by a pound sign, which is more specific, like for a specific div, redefining an existing tag, and doing compound tags. And those are, that's just the basics of selectors in the four most common types of selectors. Now I'm going to go forward from the CSS page here in through the tutorial until we get to some stuff that we haven't really talked about yet. And then we'll go ahead and add it to our CSS study guide. Now, one thing I want to talk about actually before I leave this page is this tag here, which is the body tag, right? And once again, this is if you put the body tag inside your style sheet, the body tag refers to everything that's on the page. And so what happens when you make a change here, you change the entire website, right? So for example, it says body background color light blue. So if we decided we wanted to add that style to our example over here, we would of course type in the body tag. We would of course put in the curly brace, and Dreamweaver is going to give us the closing brace, and we're going to hit our enter button. And then we could say, background blue. And then when we click up here, everything turns blue because once again, the body tag affects the entire web page. So that's like using gunpowder or something. You want to be really careful with that tag. It's very powerful, but it affects everything, right? Now I just took the blue off of there, but I want to go ahead and use this as an example of when you would use a body style. When you want to affect everything globally, right? Everything on the page. Or if this was an external style sheet, basically everything all over the website, right? One example would be a font, okay? So if I start typing the word font here, and then I put my dash and I type family, and then I hit my colon, Dreamweaver is going to help out with these things called code hints, right? And it's going to show me some of the most common font families on people's computers. Now, once again, you'll notice that there are a list of fonts, and this is because there are multiple fonts that the computer will try until it just gets exhausted, tries any old sans serif font. So if I were to go down here, I don't see Verdana, I don't see Arial. Maybe we'll use something like Gill Sans. Let's see how that looks. Now, of course, okay, it's giving us all these Gill Sans and then throwing in Helvetica and Arial and then Sans Serif at the end, right? Now, after I drop this code in, this from the code hint, I have to remember to put in a semicolon to end the line of code. And then I can click up here and you can see that my text has changed, right? And that's maybe a little cleaner look there. So we'll go ahead and leave that. Now, the other thing you can do is maybe your font size isn't big enough. Maybe you want it a little bigger. Like, this is a little small. It might be hard for you guys to read at home. So I could start typing the word font, and then I could put dash and size and put a colon. And one thing to know about font sizes is 1 em, that proportional unit of measurement, means go ahead and set the font size to the default size for the browser. So you notice when I put font size in there, 1 em, nothing really changed. But if I want the font to be slightly larger, here's a good example of where you could use a point, right? You could say like 1.3, let's say, and let's see how this text changes. See how it's bigger? And maybe that wasn't as subtle as I wanted. Let me take it back to 1 so we can see the example again. So there's 1, pretty small, right? So now we can go here and say, okay, so let me go up to the top. Let's just look at how much it changes when you go 1.1. Let's look at the change when I click in here. Okay, that's just slightly bigger. So you see that you can do, you can use the dot numbers here to make things just slightly larger until you get them the way you want them to look. So there's 1.2, right? So let's go to 1.3. I think that one actually looks pretty good. Let's see. Yeah, 1.3 is sort of readable. So we've increased the size of the font on this page here. Now, one of the reasons CSS is so important is because when you're working on your WordPress websites, if you want to make changes to things like the font or a background color or something like that, one of the easiest ways to do that is to go into the custom fonts area, or custom CSS area, which you'll find in the customize section under appearance in your dashboard, and add some CSS text, and that will go ahead and make the changes to your site. And that's exactly what we're doing here. That's why we're learning this stuff, because it's one of the most valuable tools you can have when it comes to websites. Okay, so like I said earlier, I'm going to go ahead and page through the CSS tutorial and look at some of the stuff here, and see what has value to us that we can talk about. So I may have to go through a few pages before I find something of value. Okay, here we go. So here is a definition of the CSS style sheet. So you've got the selector, right, which is in blue over here in Dreamweaver. That's basically the name of the style. Then everything inside of the curly braces is what they call a declaration. And so basically what you're saying is, here's the style, here's what I want to use, here's what I want to select, and this is what I want to do to it. It's like a math equation, right? So then you start out with a property, which is in this case the color that you want to change, and you put in a colon, which means equals, and then you put in the value. What do you want to change it to? Well, I want to change it to blue. And of course, you end every one of these little declarations with a semicolon, which means you're done with that. You've made that change, now move on. Here's the next one, font size equals 12 pixels, right? And that's just like the font size we just did here in the body. Okay, let's see. Let us go to the next page and see what's valuable here. Okay, so here they go ahead and talk about ID selector, which is what we just talked about. And you can use this as an example. Here we go ahead and talk about the class, and you can go ahead and play around with this and make some code and see how it works. Okay, and then of course I mentioned this in class, the universal selector, which is the asterisk, and I that's going to affect every element on the page, kind of like the body. I have yet to use that, but maybe there'll be a time to use that. Okay, CSS grouping selector. Grouping selector selects all HTML elements with the same definitions. So, for example, if you look here, this H1 style, the H2 style, and the P style are all the same. They're all text align center color red, right? And what you can do is, instead of writing all that code, you can just say, hey, I'm going to put commas in between these tags here and say, hey, I want my H1, my H2, and my paragraph to all have this applied to them. So that's what we would call a grouping selector. So let me go ahead and add that onto my study guide here. So we'll go down here. We're going to get another la 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 la. Okay, compound tag. So we're going to grab this stuff. going to put it down here. And we're going to say a grouping selector groups several styles into one selector. Several styles, I should say, that have similar attributes. And what I mean by that is that, you know, they're all same. Text line center, color red, into one selector. Okay. And so for the example, we're making, let's see, all texts in paragraphs green, and also all text in headlines. We'll say H1 tags. Okay, so now we're going to do that. So we're going to go up here and we're going to put a new style in into our little style sheet here. We're going to say, hey, wherever there's an H1 and there's a paragraph, like really just any, not together. This isn't a compound style because we have a comma between it. So it's not adding the two together, right? So we'll go ahead and do that and we'll say color equals green. Now, I'll click up here and you see, you know, this is an H1 tag, so it's green. And of course, most of my text is in paragraph tag, so it's green as well. But of course, here's some text that's blue. And that's inside of a paragraph tag, you know, so it probably would have turned green except for the fact that I'm calling a class here which turns it blue. So that shows you how some styles will override others. And basically, the closer the style is to your actual content, the greater chance it's going to override other styles. So that, you know, this one up here telling paragraphs to be green is way up here in the style internal style sheet. But this blue headline is right next to or in line with the content here, so it's gonna take precedence over the green, right? Okay, so that is the grouping selector. All right. So and then right here, all CSS simple selectors. So we have the class, we have the ID. Of course, there's the generic asterisk for everything. It's kind of like the body tag. We have what are called elements. I'm calling them tags, but they're officially called elements, which is things like the P. And then here's grouping elements, which is, you know, with a comma. And then, of course, we have compound, which is without the comma where you add two together. Let's go ahead and see what's on the next page here. Okay, so a lot of this stuff we're talking about is review and that we've gone over it in class. But I'm going over it again with you now so that you'll have all this information to do your take-home test. Once again, we've talked about the fact that there's different places you can put CSS. The best place to put it is in an external style sheet, which is linked to your website. Next best place is an internal style sheet, and that's what this is. It's up at the top of your website, or your web page, I should say, and it's indicated by these style tags. Begin style and end style indicates an internal style sheet. And then we have what's called inline CSS, which is CSS which is literally on the same line as the content. Now, let me give an example of inline CSS. So we'll go down to the bottom here and we'll say, put a paragraph tag in. Say, here is an example of inline CSS. And then what we'll do is, we'll put what's called a span tag around these words inline CSS. Now, a span tag is, you know, a span in real life is like an area, you know, like an expanse, a span. And what a span tag does is it says, hey, anything between the beginning span tag and the end span tag, anything in this area will be affected by the style that we add to it. So this is a good generic tag that you can use to just change something, right? So if I'm going to add my style right in here, that means I'm not even going to refer to the style sheet at the top of the page. I'm going to just add my CSS in here. So that means I have to use the word style like we did up above, and I have to say equals, and then I put in quotes, and now I go ahead and put in my, my CSS like I would at the top. So here I can say, color, purple. Let's see, put a colon here, and then purple, and then let's see, hit enter up here, and let's scroll down. Okay. Now see how this turned purple where everything else is green? Once again, it's because the style is in line. It's right next to the content, so it's going to take precedence over that general style, right? Okay, so we talked about an inline style, which is this right here. We talked about an internal style sheet, which is this one here. So now we should show an example of an external style sheet. So an external style sheet is a separate file which holds all your styles, okay? Now, you can have both internal and external style sheets. You can also have inline styles all on the same page. But once again, just having everything on an external style sheet is a best practice. It's the best way to do things, right? Now, if I want to make a style sheet, I can go up here to Dreamweaver, click on Dreamweaver here, and go File New, and just click on CSS to say that I want to make a style sheet. Okay, so it's just going to create a generic blank style sheet. Now what I want to do is save that in the same folder as my HTML web page that I'm making. So I go ahead, it finds the folder right away. A good name to call your style sheet is just style.css, right? Now, right now we've got two files inside of the files folder, the index page, which is the one we've been working on. And then right next to it as a tab comes up the style sheet, right? The style sheet has no styles on it. In addition, the two pages can't talk to each other because they don't know, they're kind of blind, they don't know the other one's there. So that means that on this HTML page, we have to put a link which links this page to the style sheet so that the computer can go out there and look for code on that external style sheet. So let's see how we would make a link. Well, you would make a link in between the head tags of your HTML page here. So I'm going to go ahead and click after the first HTML tag. And then we'll go ahead and put in our link, right? Our external link to a style sheet. Now, if we scroll down a little bit on this page over here, the W3 Schools tutorial, we can see that they have the link to an external style sheet right here. So we can go ahead and highlight that and copy it and put it into our page here. And let's just examine it real quick. So it says that it's a link. It's a tag, has these angle brackets around it. It says that the type of link it is it's linking to a page that has text and CSS on it. href means this is what it's going to link to, the actual file it's going to link to, right? And so we would change this to be a style.css because that's what we call our page. And then rel equals style sheet means what kind of, link is this? It's a link to a style sheet file, right? Okay, now if we go ahead and save our HTML page here, we now have a page that is linked to an external style sheet, which is this one right here. Now, you remember that tag we did before, which was the body tag, which turned everything blue, right? So I can add another body tag here because you can have multiple of the same style names. You can just put different things in each one. It's not very efficient, but sometimes you need to do stuff like that. So we'll just say background color is blue again. I'll take out some of this extra space here. I'll go ahead and save this. And let's go back to our index page. And sure enough, everything turns blue because now we have an internal style sheet, plus we have an external style sheet. So it's grabbing styles from all those. And of course, way down at the bottom, we have an inline style, that span tag. Now I don't want this thing to be blue. So what I'm going to do is, but let's say, and this is a good example of what's called a comment, right? Now a comment is rendered in gray and is not actually executed on your web page, but it helps you with information about your styles, right? So let's say that, maybe I don't want my page to be blue now, but maybe I want it to be blue in the future. So what I want to do is take this style out of commission. I basically want to comment it out, which means that the style's still there, but it's not active. Now in Dreamweaver, you can do it quite easily. You highlight the style and you come over to this little icon here. It looks like a word balloon. And you say that you want to go ahead and comment this out. Okay. Now to comment it out, you are highlighting it. You come over here, click on the little word balloon, and you come to the second choice here. If you're in CSS, it says apply, and then it says a certain kind of comment. And the comment is forward slash and then an asterisk, and then later on an asterisk and a forward slash. Now, if we do that, it does that. It puts a forward slash, then an asterisk at the beginning, just like what we have up here, and then it puts the opposite asterisk and then forward slash at the end here, like we have here. What happens is it turns everything gray and it's no longer active, but it's there on your page. So if you ever wanted to, have this start up again, you could just remove that comment, and now that would be an active style, but we don't want it, so we're gonna comment it out like that. Right now, whenever in Dreamweaver, whenever you have a little asterisk here by the name of your file, that means it's a change has been made, but it hasn't been saved yet. Right. Okay, so all right, so I think I'm gonna go ahead and stop there with our little the first section of our CSS study guide. Hopefully this will be helpful to you guys. You can look this over and watch the video and kind of follow along and do the stuff. Stop it whenever you need to and back up. Stop it when you need to take a break or whatever. And just go through this stuff so that you know it, and so you can do well on the take-home test, and so it can help you when you're working on your WordPress websites. Okay, that's it for the video for today.